We talk a lot about prediabetes and insulin and the epidemic of it going on and how serious it is. In fact, I joined the CDC and ADA in this space in terms of being a fearmonger. and we'll cover why. As you start, but the question comes up is, well, just how common is prediabetes or insulin resistance? And what are some of the things that are related to it? What should we be thinking about? Well, there are some expanding definitions from the CDC and ADA. Then you have to ask yourself the question, why are they expanding the definitions? Because they know of the damage associated with it. Obesity is increasing. We're getting older. Gum disease is a related issue. Why? We'll talk about that. Well, you could also look at the outcomes. Heart attack, stroke, retinopathy, kidney disease, erectile dysfunction. All of these things are very much, we've got numbers on them, and they're very much related to this issue. So let's start running through that real quick. Yes, the CDC has broadened the definition. Back in 2000, 2003, there were more people with official diagnosis of diabetes than insulin resistance. That diabetes has increased from about, 20% up to 26%, but insulin resistance or prediabetes has increased from about 15% up to 84%. Why is that? Well, as you see in each of these areas, you've had a significant jump. And the jump has included a significant broadening of the CDC definition. So that's clearly happening. Now, how should we interpret that? Well, Charles Piller in Science magazine interpreted it as a dubious diagnosis. He said, most people don't go on to get full-blown diabetes, so what are we worried about? And in fact, he also said, there are no complications from prediabetes. Dumb, that's not true. And it's unfortunate that it's not true. Diabetic retinopathy is the leading cause of blindness in adults. And about 30% of patients already have type 2 diabetic retinopathy, by the time they get a diagnosis of type 2 diabetes. So don't tell me, Charles Piller, that prediabetes has no complications. Now, let's go back and look at some other numbers that are related to this. Obesity. I've done a video recently on the growing obesity epidemic in the U.S. It's now at the point where 7 states report obesity at or above 35%. In other words, over a third of the state is now obese. Well, now what's the connection between the obesity epidemic and the insulin resistance epidemic or prediabetes epidemic? Here it is, and this is a little bit geeky. It's the biochemical components. This is the cell wall, this black thing. And this is the insulin receptor, this blue thing. Insulin, when it goes into the bloodstream, it touches these receptors in the cell wall and makes the cell wall pull blood sugar out of the blood when it's too high and into the cell where it's protected. It doesn't do the damage that it does in the bloodstream. But what is this over here? This is another receptor. It's an adipokine or adipokine, depending on how you want to pronounce it. But it's a receptor of inflammatory markers, TNF, tissue necrosis factor, IL-6, interleukin-6, leptin, free fatty acids. These are all products of fat. So we increase our fat mass, we increase all of these products, and then look what happens. We decrease our body's ability to respond to insulin. So that is the connection. It's a very clear biochemical metabolic connection between insulin resistance and obesity. How about gum disease? Half of Americans have gum disease. You go to the dentist, and if you have bleeding, you've got gum disease. Now, what's the connection there? Well, the high-risk dental pathogens or periodontal pathogens, the bacteria that cause gum disease, also cause this. They cause the a core process of insulin resistance or inflammation associated with insulin resistance. This is the artery. It's a diagram or schematic. These little yellow dots are LDL in the blood, and this is a growing plaque. The pink layer is the endothelium or intima. And here's the thing. Dysfunction and permeability of the endothelium is driven by those same oral pathogens, the same bacteria that cause bleeding in your gums. So again, another connection between periodontal disease and insulin resistance. Now, I'd done another video recently about the connection between the new metabolic pathway, saying it's not really holes in the endothelium. Myself and others have been guilty of using that terminology, especially when we describe the microalbumin-creatinine ratio, a core test for inflammation. As this researcher has shown, it's not really so much holes in the endothelium. It is, however, increased permeability of that endothelium, where LDL goes through the endothelial wall and gets stuck between the endothelium and the media, the muscular support layer of that artery wall. Now, here's some other ways. Talking about other things that are associated with insulin resistance, prevalence of insulin resistance, and or the cardiovascular inflammation that goes with it. And we all know there's increasing prevalence, increasingly common, stroke, dementia, heart attack, heart failure, kidney failure, erectile dysfunction, and peripheral disease. Let me go back and say I misspoke on stroke. We've actually had some decrease in stroke, and again, it's been associated with our improving management of high blood pressure, also related to insulin resistance. Now, as we look at those diseases, you know, pardon me, this is such a silly comment. The medical community surrounded. Again, who cares about the medical community? It's the patients that are suffering these diseases. Let's go back and look at these diseases. Approximately every 40 seconds, an American has a heart attack. And every 4 minutes, someone dies from a stroke in the U.S. And that's a little bit less than it used to be, but again. So with stroke, we're getting some decrease associated with improved blood pressure management, but we're continuing to get an upward pressure because of the continued increase in obesity and insulin resistance rates in the population. Now, I continue to talk about prediabetes or insulin resistance and artery disease as if they're linked. How are they linked? Inflammation. Actually, there was a very smart guy that knew this 157 years ago. He made the comment. His name was Virchow. The doctors have heard of him because they've heard of him from other places, and some historians have heard of him. He was the first medical director of the Charité Institute. It was the big hospital, more Nobel Prize winners in medicine from that hospital than anywhere else. It's near Berlin, I think. anyway, he said 157 years ago, the lesions of atherosclerosis represent a very specific inflammatory response on a cellular level. Well, we seem to have forgotten that until recently, past 20 years ago. And you see one of the authors here, Paul Ridker. I've mentioned his name many, many times. Circulation just a few years ago, 2002. Atherosclerosis represents a cellular inflammatory response from the beginning deposit of oxidized LDL to the end, with rupture of pockets of liquefied inflammatory cellular responses. So again, I've gone through these slides, these images, multiple times in other videos. This is an artery that's relatively normal on the left side, in bad shape on the right side. As you see, it's not the buildup of plaque is not like hair in the inside of a drain where their flow is. The the plaque, or LDL, is going through that intima, that slick lining, and getting stuck between the intima and media layer. The immune system, as this progresses, is beginning to say, look, that shouldn't be there. And the immune system does what it does always. It sends immune cells there. The immune cells release enzymes. And guess what? Those enzymes start to digest that plaque. But unfortunately, all of that works well until you get to this point. Unfortunately, the hot liquid resulting plaque, when it breaks through, if it breaks through, back through the intima and touches liquid blood, it causes a clot. And sure enough, that's what's happening here. This is a real artery of a person. This is the red media layer. This is a intima lining. And in between there, you have a huge amount of grayish, brownish looking plaque. Here you have a hot liquid area. And as you can see, that immune system has created that liquid area of plaque, and there's only that layer of intima in between that and the liquid blood flow. This is what happened here. This is the media layer there. That's plaque with a developing hot plaque pocket there. This was a large hot plaque pocket until the intima cracked. The hot plaque touched the blood, formed a large clot. The majority of the clot broke off, flowed to the heart, killed this patient. And the rest of this black that you see here is not hot plaque. It's parts of the clot that formed right on into that pocket area. Now, we already know a lot of the major outcomes and inputs here. Endodontic disease, periodontal disease, genetics, 9P21, some of the other diseases, inflammatory diseases. But the big one is insulin resistance. And if you get insulin resistance and it gets worse and worse, diabetes. Inflammatory diseases, by the way, for the patient, the few patients, relatively few patients that have them, cause as much heart attack and stroke, or are at increased risk of heart attack and stroke as much as insulin resistance or diabetes. But let's get back. I've gone far afield here. Let's go back to just how common this is. Again, the CDC numbers, 84.1 million. In other words, a third of adults, according to the CDC, have prediabetes. And yes, only 1 out of 10 know it. That is scary. Especially if you're one of those fearmongers like me about this issue. How about this? What's the breakdown? As you see with 45 to 64-year-olds, 40% percent of 37-44% of insulin of these folks have insulin resistance. Now, the reason I showed that number is I want to go back and compare the CDC to the UCLA numbers. Many of you have heard me mention the UCLA numbers. UCLA said half, over half, of adults in California have insulin resistance. And when you get to the healthier group, the younger group, 1 out of 3 have it. So are these just diametric? That's a significant difference, a half, over half versus about a third. Is it that the CDC is wrong, or UCLA is wrong, or they're just different? I would vote for they're just different. Here's a couple of issues. Number one, UCLA numbers are focused on the state of California, and the state of California does have a lot more people of color, Pacific Islanders, American Indians, African Americans, which tend to have higher prevalence of prediabetes. The other thing is the UCLA study was probably a little bit more recent, just published a little over a year ago. Now, again, looking at minorities or people of color, let's look at a couple of numbers. Pacific Islanders, age 55 to 70 plus, they have numbers up to 76% have insulin resistance or diabetes or prediabetes. American Indian, 70%, 70 and above. So these are huge, huge numbers. Now let's go back and think about it a little bit differently. So UCLA and CDC numbers are built basically on fasting blood glucose and hemoglobin A1c. We know hemoglobin A1c could actually miss a lot of insulin resistance. Some people would say it misses A1c misses insulin resistance up to 50% of the time as compared to OGTT. And fasting blood glucose or sugar is even worse. So think about it. If that's the case, then even the UCLA numbers might very well be low. So you've made it this far. Thank you again for your interest. Now you're beginning to see maybe why I'm one of those scaremongers that Piller mentioned in his article. We've got an epidemic of a very serious disease, and it is the major risk factor for heart attack, stroke, the number one cause of death, the number one cause of disability, and a whole lot of other really bad stuff in this country. And only 1 out of 10 people knows it. Thank you for your interest. If you hit the like button, and for sure if you subscribe or share, the algorithm reads that as a strong message that humans think this is interesting and important information. And the algorithm can share it more than any of us humans. speaking of sharing, one of the best ways of sharing is on social media. We've got active Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn activities going on right now. We've recently started up things in Pinterest and Twitter, so we'd love to see you there. Check us out. Finally, with over 500 videos, a lot of people are saying, I can't find this video or that video. Our new social media manager, Kim Hermosa, is starting to work on ways to help with that. So join the community. You can click on the links below and you can get a little bit better access. Thank you again for your interest.